web apps in ClojureScript for the greater good. Thank you everyone for coming. That was a really, I just have to acknowledge Alex's remarks, opening remarks. I think it's a great way to start the conference. If we could get another round of applause for her, that's just amazing. Thank you.
Great, so this is David, I'm Shelby. A little bit about us before we begin. We both are members at Code for Denver, where we hack on lots of things for the greater good. I really like APIs. This is my information. I work at a company called HealthFi, where we work to address social determinants of health.
And like Shelby said, my name is David Viramontes. I love functional programming, Lisp, and that's some of my contact information. Right now, I'm a full-stack developer at a company called Levels Beyond in Denver. And yeah, that's a little bit about us.
Code for Denver. So we meet every Monday for 3 hours. Many of us meet even more than that. We're a great community, so if you're interested in helping out, then please join us. We meet at Galvanize in the Golden Triangle. It's on Spear and 11th.
And for people that are in Boulder, there's also a chapter, a Boulder chapter of Code for America. You're welcome to attend that as well.
And one of our goals at Code for Denver is basically the tenet of Code for America. We're one of the brigades. They have brigades across the country. And that tenet is that we build government for the people, by the people, for the 21st century. And the way that we do that is we do work with the local government a little bit, but we also partner with nonprofits. And we try and bring an agile approach to our projects that we work on, specifically problems in our community. And we're going to talk about one of those today.
Is this my life? Sorry. Yeah. So one of these projects that we've recently been participating on is a project called Outlet in partnership with a community organization called Open World Learning. As with any Code for Denver project, we try to engage with the community as much as possible and have accountability and all those things and deep connections into what we do. Our thought is that if we empower the nonprofit or the organization, they empower, we get to be multipliers, right? In that sort of chain of empathy, if you will. And the problem that we're trying to solve here is that we treat, as Michelle from Al explains, more and more kids are taught to do the computer thing instead of the real computer science thing, which is to enable them by treating the computer as a tool, not as a sort of way to just enter work, busy work. So that's kind of the problem that we're trying to solve with Outlet.
And so to really address the issue, one of the things that we learned after talking with some of the people involved in OWL and some of the teachers working with these students, these middle schoolers specifically, is that the teachers spent more time grading and making sure that the students had completed things rather than actually working with the students to teach them how to program. So we set out to solve that problem with the solution, Owlet, which is an open source tech learning platform. Students can submit their activities, they can get points for the things that they submit, teachers can easily mark things as complete or not so that teachers can actually focus on the job of teaching. And we did this in Clojure.
So let's talk about a little bit why Clojure, right? For us, it's kind of, it's been an interesting story. It's been rewarding and challenging at the same time. And this talk hopefully highlights some of those points. But Clojure specifically, it promises, what it does for me is that it sort of makes very hard things very possible. And I think it delivers on that promise. And you'll see some of the things that we get to do because we're using sort of a better way to craft our software. So this is kind of like the usual thing you hear about Clojure, that is practical, that is a fast programming language, that is dynamic, that is simple. And I want to highlight some of the strengths that we see and we've been definitely been taking for our advantage. It's a functional language. It's immutable by default. It emphasizes data over abstractions that are complicated to reason about. So you have things like literals everywhere. It's a Lisp, so code is data. So you know, it's easy to have code that generates code and things like that. It has same concurrency models, which we use to some extent in Outlet as well. We get this through you know, some of the utilities in Clojure, such as coalescing, atoms, agents, dynamic bars, things like that. It has a fast development cycle for us. Developing on the front end is a very kind of iterative experience. Same thing on the server. You can be changing basically all the code in the back end and not have to restart once. It's simple and well, it feels like a well-designed language. So that's some of the strengths on a high level. Clojure gets to borrow a lot of ideas. It just steals them from other communities. So these are some of the things that we get from other communities. And one of the things that really, really, really makes Clojure, the fact that it's a Lisp, a very powerful ecosystem, the fact that it can, you know, as a library, ship something that Go has in terms of core async. You know, we get type annotations like compile time, whatever, with type bracket, prolog, we get core logic, and these are semantics for programming in logic programming. CLJSRN is a way to build native React Native applications in ClojureScript. Again, fast iteration cycle. REPL, all the things. Reframe, which is a way to like do functional programming on the front end. This is along the lines of Elm and flux patterns and stuff like that in the front end. We also get test check from Haskell. So there's a lot of things that I could go on and on. This list is long about the things that we borrow from other communities, just good ideas in general. And lastly, you know, Clojure has taught me the, sort of the value of what this means. The difference between something being simple and something easy, right? And I really encourage you to seek out that talk by Rich Hickey, Simple Made Easy. Simple Matters, Simplicity Matters, sorry. You can find it on YouTube, but the ideas of Clojure are, you know, are prevalent in other communities as well. We see them influencing React and other stuff too. So it's both ways.
So why did we choose to build a web app? At Code for Denver, we often build web applications. There sometimes is a ridiculous amount of debate about what language to do it in, or if we even should be doing web apps rather than native apps. And before I go into the reasons about why we chose a web app, I'm just going to give everybody a refresher about what a web app is, in case you're not used to working in the web. So I drew this because I'm a great drawer, obviously. I've got my pretty client, which is my desktop computer. It goes to a website, butterfly.com, where you can see pretty pictures of butterflies. And the way that it gets that information about the butterflies is it sends an HTTP request to an API, which sits in front of the database and all the business logic associated with the application. And then the API will send back a response containing the data to the desktop or whatever client you're using. And this can also be on a little iPhone, which I drew right there. So it's basic tenets of the architecture of web applications. And maybe you can begin to see some of the benefits of having a web app, especially in a community nonprofit volunteer organization like Code for Denver, which is that with a web app, we can be on pretty much any device, Windows, iPhone, Android, desktops, any OS, really, that has a browser. It's a fast iterative process, so we can make changes really quickly. We don't have to wait for the App Store to give us approval to ship anything. And with continuous deployment, we can ship things really fast. And this also allows us to have an API-first architecture, which you can do with having a native-first approach as well. But one of the things that we really try and do is have extensibility. So if we have an API-first architecture, then we can have a web app for our first MVP. And then once that goes in the field, gets lots of user feedback, then we can find out that maybe we really do need an iOS app. And at that point, it's just a matter of building an iOS client to consume our API.
So to tell you a little bit more about what this means for us in practice is that some of the trade-offs are that you get to use the same language back and front end if you want that sort of thing. We found Only a few cases where that's actually beneficial, but you could deliver on that promise of sharing code validation for forms and code validation before things go into the database, for example. So you can apply the same set of form validation fields with types and stuff like that if you want. There's this idea that there are no big frameworks in Clojure. It's just a matter of pick and choose your libraries. And that can be liberating in terms of like understanding the complexity of your app and then just decoupling things. And I think it really fits well with what we're trying to do at Code for Denver and with Outlet, where we're trying to make things behave as if they were microservices or services that behave independent of, they know less about what the context is that they run on. So,
so just a brief example of what a web app in Clojure might look like, a really simple example of the file structure. So we have this at the top or inside of the source directory, we have this Clojure CLJ directory, which has our routes, it has our business logic, it has some of that API code. At the very bottom, we'll have the front end, the CLJS, that's the Clojure script, which contains everything that's going to compile the HTML and JavaScript. And in the middle, we have the shared source, where we can actually share some of these form validations that David was speaking about a few minutes ago. And that's something that's pretty interesting and powerful in terms of sharing code and not having to duplicate yourself.
Yeah. And I would even say that that the namespaces alone in the front end is reason enough to use ClojureScript, right? Because we all know what nightmare that is. You know, NPM versus require.js versus like whatever next thing is, it can be kind of a nightmare. So it's a great convention to follow.
So for Owlet, we took this a bit further. We didn't want to have all of that code in the same repository. We wanted to break it up even more to really have a decoupled front end and back end. So this is what our architecture looks like. I will let David explain this.
Yeah, so it's still playing along with this idea that everything is independent. And there really is no center, right? Like in the classical, like LNK, things should be decoupled, right? Like entities. Everything just talks to HTTP, and that sort of has made us be more flexible and fast and iterative on the pieces that matter, and let rely on the network to sort of make things easier for us. And if we wanted to go with a different backend solution later, we could because it's a different piece, right? There is no center, and that's a better design for this kind of thing. This is what we're experimenting with.
And I want to point out here that you'll see in the corners, we have some external services that we're using.
Yeah.
So we've basically outsourced our authentication to Auth0, which has made the development process even faster, as well as our CMS functionality for containing the activities and the things that the students upload. That's all outsourced to Contentful CMS. And they've been kind enough to give us that for free because we're awesome. And I do also want to point out really quick this Owlet status over here on the right. It's a really interesting concept that David has put in place for this project, which is just a small, really small Clojure service that pings all of our extra services to make sure everything's up. So we can know immediately, you know, if something's down. It's very, very fast, milliseconds, and it's pretty awesome. And it's going to be open source, or is open source?
Yes, yes.
and everything is containerized as well.
Yeah. Cool. So to give you an idea of what a front end piece of code might look like in ClojureScript. What you see on the left is the template or the view, the welcome view, which is really a function that returns a set of vectors, which are you can think of them as arrays if you're not familiar with Clojure data structures, but they sort of allow you to express your views in terms of what you mean, right? So the intent is there. I don't think there's anyone here who doesn't understand this. If you've done a little bit of HTML, you probably can already tell what the left does. And it just outputs what's on the right. So it's a React view that allows us to express the code in terms of composable functions.
So this is an example of some backend code. This when the front end, the UI makes an HTTP request to, our API, it gets routed through the routes we've defined. So it's just a small example of our user routes. So if it hits the user/ID, then it will get passed to this handle single user lookup function, which then will do some crazy if let stuff and find our user. And then it will respond with OK, found the user, or not found, and return a 404. So the DSL for this is pretty simple, and it's one of the powers of some of these small libraries that we can use in Clojure.
Yeah. This is a different example of how we get to use immutability and the things that I was kind of talking about before. The concurrency aspects of it, the sort of the ability to think about your code synchronously, but it behaves very not synchronously, meaning that it will dispatch when it gets a request for retrieval of all the entries for a given user. It goes out and then uses all my cores in my computer to distribute all these HTTP calls to go outside, and then resolves them all in a bundle called contentful entries URLs. And then that's what we respond with in the end. So this code might look synchronous, but it's actually using as much power as it can in my computer to be able to distribute that computation, join it, and then return a response. So this is one of the clever things that you can do in Clojure. Again, just to reiterate on the powerful abstractions concept, where this last line that is highlighted in blue tells you a little bit about the power of destructuring, and not only destructuring things that are native to sort of Clojure, but you can also destructure things that are asynchronous. So this at the bottom with the at symbol is a promise that gets resolved with the response of this request. And then at the very end, we just take the pieces that we care about and then go on with all this. So this is another example of how this destruction just saves a lot of boilerplate, if you will.
And this is just some more code from the back end to throw an example of how we use these external services. So when we work with Auth0 and Contentful CMS, we are making HTTP requests to them, but we're also receiving requests from them through webhooks, which is just an interesting example of this two-way HTTP communication that we're utilizing to really have a distributed microservices network. And it's kind of complicated, so I'll just leave it there. If you want to learn more about how the different pieces interact, then come chat later.
And some of the other cool things that we've been experimenting with recently is this idea that you can have FRP, or functional reactive programming, in the front end, meaning that you can react to things, subscribe to things, publish things. And that turns out to be a very clever idea that, you know, in the Elm community and some of the Flux patterns, the newer ones, you get to do. You get to sort of reduce computations and things like that. And in here, we have an example of what it is like to subscribe to an event. So in this login component, we have a little bit of state. And the state of this button depends on the subscription of this event. And down here, you have the subscription of the handler, which determines what happens to that reactive process, where state changes, gets propagated out, and this is how we handle it. We go out and retrieve keys from that map, and we say, user, is the user logged in? And we get to express the application state in a very sort of functional way. Less dependent on what happens synchronously, and more what happens when events get triggered from the user or from the network. And this is the other side of that coin, where you get to dispatch. So this dispatching can happen from a user clicking on a button, and then the handler on the bottom describes what happens when the action gets triggered. It navigates the cursor, the tree of state, and then it says, I'm going to associate this key with the value that I'm passed in. It doesn't know anything but the value of the computation that is concerned with here. So it gets to be smaller, less sort of hairy state transactions and stuff like that.
So just to briefly go over some of the main points about the benefits of using Clojure, and specifically in this web application, but in general at Code for Denver, we get to have a really powerful client-server separation, more so than we might get with, say, a Rails monolith. We have this immutability concept that we have to really understand, which David is so great at teaching to everybody. Powerful abstractions, especially a lot of these powerful small libraries that we can use. We get to incorporate reactive programming. as well as by default have a microservices architecture.
And we also want to acknowledge some of the challenges that it is to bring or to onboard people into sort of this ecosystem. So these are some of those onboarding. You know, Clojure is a Lisp, and we're not going to get away from that, right? So that's it's funny. We have that here, but for me, it's one of the greatest strengths about Clojure that it is a Lisp. But a lot of people see that as something that they can't get over the parentheses. And they just can't see the structure within the thing, right? So, but you know, there are ways to sort of mitigate the complexity that comes with S expressions and things like that. There are tools for this. So what are some of these challenges? Concretely, so we have like things like IDEs. Not all IDEs or text editors are set up to handle S expressions. So parent matching in your head should not. You should not be doing this. Talk to someone. Talk to us. We'll sort of guide you through that problem. It's just a matter of installing plugins and stuff like that, and you'll be fine. You can use it. You don't have to be an Emacs expert to use Clojure. I'm not. I'm certainly not. I use IntelliJ, and I love it. I'm just checking the time here. And then you can use it with Atom, Sublime, or whatever you want. But it does require a different way of thinking about your code also.
And setting up environment is really painful from first-hand experience.
Sometimes, yes.
Yeah, sometimes, yeah. Yes. So that's definitely like a big part of onboarding people at Code for Denver to Clojure, is sometimes it might take the entire night.
Just, yeah. Especially more like computers don't come with Java installed and things like that. We just have to get over those things. But great resources out there, definitely. But there needs to be more, and because there's all kinds of learners out there, right? So yeah, that's something to highlight. Let's see. And then we also have Clojure Solisp, again, because, again, the parentheses seems to be a big roadblock for a lot of people. But again, we can kind of surpass that with the right tooling. You have to think about your code differently. There's no assignments. You can't like just change stuff later. Like, you have to think about your code differently. And you must give up previous notions of programming. Some bad habits, and then you get new ones. Some bad new ones, or bad good ones. It depends.
Yeah, we've sometimes found that actually people who are new to programming pick up Clojure faster than people who've been doing other programming languages for a long time, because they're so used to that object orientation and having global state, perhaps, where they shouldn't.
Right.
So if you want to check out more of the work that we've been doing, here's our information, github.com, Code for Denver. It has all of our projects ever, not just these three. These are our three main components, the repositories on our GitHub. If you want to learn more about us, codefordenver.org. I think we also have .com. So check us out. And also, in case you're around next weekend, National Day of Civic Hacking is happening in Denver. We're going to be focusing on housing problems in the city, because that's increasingly a pretty big problem. And it's also going on throughout the country. So if you're not in Denver or Boulder, then find your local brigade. They're almost certainly doing an event. And join. Start hacking.
And used to sort of like along the lines of the keynote speak, right, the first presenter, this is something that is at the core of what we do. It's this idea that the craft of programming begins with empathy. It's not, you know, really about languages or the tools or the algorithms of Clojure or whatever it might be. It's really about empathizing with the problem statement and empathizing about the people that use your software. So this is what, at the core, what we do, and it's an invitation, I guess, for you to join us.
And it's kind of one of the reasons why Clojure is great for Code for Denver, is because parentheses are, you know, just like hugs for your code. So thank you, everybody.
Thanks.